like to welcome you all to the National Museum of the American Indian today, and we have a special guest with us, Mr. Grayhawk Perkins, all the way from New Orleans, so we're really happy to have him here today. We're happy to have you here, and I'm going to turn it over to him.
Oh, okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Well, I'm glad that you guys came to visit me today. My name's Grayhawk Perkins. Actually, I got a real weird name. My whole name is about that long. And everybody asks me, it says, Andres Tiasla Bianake Abibioa, weird last name Perkins. But I'm of the Muscogee Nation. My mother is Houma in Choctaw, and my dad is Choctaw. And I grew up in New Orleans, and below New Orleans and outside of New Orleans. And in our area, in Louisiana, we have about 64,000 Native Americans. We have Cushadas, we have Chittimaches, we have the Houma, we have Choctaw, and we all live in New Orleans, in the Louisiana area. And it was really cool. In New Orleans area, below New Orleans, we have about 14,000 Native Americans that live there, that are Houma, and then we also have some transplant natives that live in our area. Now, I grew up in pretty much traditional Native household. My grandmother was really traditional. That's who I learned a lot of my stories from, and a lot of things that I know was from my grandmother. And my grandfather was a great storyteller. And I just grew up, as I was growing up, it was just something that you did. You sat down, you listened, and they would tell you stories. And that's how we passed on what our ancestors did. And that's what I do today. I remember at, I guess her age, even at 3 years old, I would sit down and I'd have all these elders, and they would sit around the table at night, and that's what they would do. They would talk, because at the time we didn't really have television, you know. And even after television came along, I noticed that, you know, during the time when the family got together, which was regular, I mean, you know, we all lived around each other in the community, that we would they would sit down and they would start telling stories and they would start talking. And I just got to the point where I would sit either under the table or right by the door and I'd start listening. And I was just happy that I had that time. I was in that transition area in our culture in New Orleans, where in 63 was the first year that Native Americans were openly allowed in public school in Louisiana. And so a lot of our people were not exposed to a lot of the outside world in a lot of ways. I lucked out, you know. We moved up into the New Orleans area, and I was able to experience both cultures. I still was able to be around my grandparents weekly, and I was still able to see what was going on in the outside world. And so a lot of my stories have to deal with both the transition, the old traditional, and a lot of stories that I see today in our communities and our kids and people go through. And I'll use a lot of animals in my stories. I'm going to talk about one of the stories, and it was funny because I went outside earlier and I looked at what we had around the museum, and I started looking at some of the plants, and they were starting to give me ideas of different stories that we had. And I looked down there and there was a plant that I noticed downstairs, and I automatically said, I gotta tell this story. And we're gonna use Samantha in this story. She, the main person or the main character in the story is gonna be called Samantha today. How's that sound? Pretty good? Okay. Well, there was this plant, this little plant, not that big, and she was so lonely. She would sit there and she'd cry all day long. Oh, I'm so lonely. And all the animals and plants would never come around her. You know why? Because the poison that she had been given to protect her was so intense. It was so strong that if any animal or plant came by, they would get sick and they would die. And no animal, plant, even grass would go around her. And she got so lonely. She'd look up at the sky and say, Abamico, please, please, I'm so lonely. What can I do? And the Creator looked down and says, what do you want? And she says, I'm lonely. I got too much poison. Nobody likes me. And the Creator goes, well, what do you want to do? She says, I want to get rid of this poison. Then all the animals I could be friends with. Creator says, okay, this is what we'll do. Today, if you can find three animals that would take your poison equally, then I'll let you get rid of the poison. But if you don't find any animals before the sun goes down today, you have to keep the poison. Is that a deal? And the little plant, Samantha says, yes, it's a deal. So the Creator left it at that. She looked up at the sky and she said, Abamiko, Abamiko, please. I want to get rid of this poison. Help me talk to all the animals. And the Abamiko said, okay. And she was able to talk to all the animals. And she said, animals, plants, I have poison to protect you if you want it. Come and get it. So she waited. She sat there and she waited and she waited. And time went by. And she's watching the sun and it's starting to move. And she's getting worried because no animals are coming. Then finally, she sees the grass separating. It was doing this. What do you think that was? That was a snake. And it got right to the edge of the where there was mud, no grass, and it looked over at Samantha the plant, and they said, I heard you getting rid of some of your poison. I'll take it to protect me. And Samantha the plant said, I will give you the poison if you promise me this. Snake says, whatever, I'll promise you anything. I'll take if I can get the poison. Plant said, you have to warn anyone first before you bite them. You have to give them a warning. Snake thought about it, said, I can do that. It was a nice snake. So the snake said, I will do this. If animal, anything comes up to me and it looks like it's going to hurt me, I will cock my head back and open my mouth and shake my tail, and they'll see the white inside of my mouth and know that if they don't back up, I'm going to bite them. Plant goes, sounds like a good deal. It's okay, I'll give you the poison. And the snake tells her, thank you, Yokoki. Turns around and slithers off and kept its promise. It's the cottonmouth water moccasin. When you walk up to a cottonmouth and you get close, it cocks up the whole half of its body and it cocks its head back and it just opens its mouth and you see that white inside? That means back up, because if you don't, then it's going to get you. Kept its promise. So the plant's still sitting there, still looking around and hoping that somebody else comes. He's still got two pieces of poison to get rid of. Well, sun's way up in the sky, and all of a sudden that little plant sees something else coming through the weeds, through the grass, and it stops and it looks over at Samantha and says, I came to get some poison. I heard you getting rid of some poison. Could you please give it to me? I could use it to protect myself. Samantha says the same thing. I will give you the poison if you promise me that you will warn anyone before you bite them. Give them a chance. Snake there sat down and thought about it and said, I got an idea. If anyone comes near me and they get close and they look like they're going to hurt me, I will rattle my tail. And if they don't back up, I'll bite them. Plant goes, sounds like a good deal. You can have the poison. And the snake said, thank you, Yokoki. Turned around and slid it off. And that snake has kept his promise. If you run up a rattlesnake and you stop and you look like you might hurt it, it's going to do this. It'll back up. And if you don't take and back up from it, what do you think that snake's going to do to you? It's going to bite you. But that's your warning. Well, time goes by a little bit more, and that sun's just getting down in the sky, and it's about right there. And the plant is worried. Plant's worried, because if that plant doesn't get rid of that last bit of poison, she gets it all back. She had to get rid of all of it. So, the plant starts crying, and all of a sudden, through the weeds, through the grass, you see this really fast coming through. But it's real small. And it gets right at the edge and it says, "Hey, plant, I want your poison and I want it right now." The plant goes, "Whoa, wait a minute, you are rude. Howling at me like that." The little snake goes, "Excuse me, I'm here to get your poison. I want it now. Give it to me. I know you got to get rid of it. I heard that you got to get rid of it by the end of the day or you're going to get it right back. I want it right now." And the plant says, "You are rude. I'm not giving you any of my poison." Snake looks at it and goes, "You got to give me the poison. You have to give me the poison." Plant says, "I don't have to give you the poison. I'm going to wait." Snake says, "You can wait till the rest of the day, but nobody's going to come." And the plant says, "Why?" "Because I told every animal and plant that you got rid of the poison already. So now you got to give it to me." Ooh, that was a sneaky little snake. She said, no, I don't believe you." He says, "Yep, I did. You don't see anybody coming, do you?" And she sat and said, "I'm going to wait a minute." She said, "I'm going to give you 5 minutes. I'll come back." And the snake slithered off and she waited and waited. And she goes, "Oh my goodness, the sun's going down." Snake comes back, "You ready to give me the poison?" She says, "I guess I have to, but I really don't want to, but I have to." She says, "Can you promise me this?" He says, "I'm not promising you anything. Just give me the poison." And she says, "Well, listen to me. If I give you the poison, will you warn anyone before you bite them?" And the little snake looks at her. "I'm not warning anybody. Look at me. I'm little. If they come near me, they look at me, they even look at me cross-eyed, I'm going to bite them." And she thought about it. She looked at the sun. She didn't want that poison back. So she looked at the snake and she says, "Snake, it's against my best judgment, but here you go. I'll give you the poison." Snake took the poison, didn't even say thank you, turned around and left. That snake was a pygmy rattlesnake. And if you see a pygmy rattlesnake, you put your hand down, you go anywhere near, it's going to bite you. It kept its promise. It's not even going to warn you. Now, all those three snakes went off, and before you know it, the grass started growing around that plant. And the butterflies started coming, and the bees were coming, and the animals were coming. She was so happy. Samantha was happy. And you know what? She became the marigold that we know now, that became a plant that you can make medicine to help bites and get rid of poison. And that's the story of Samantha the marigold and how those three snakes got their poison. A true Muskogean tale. Thank you. I hope y'all enjoyed that one. You like that? You know what? That's your story now. You can tell that for the rest of your life. It's the Samantha story. Yes, indeed. I like that grin. She's happy about being the marigold. All right, you want to hear another story? How about a song? You want to sing with me? Yeah. Well, I'm going to do a song. And here where I live, you know, we do have some drum songs. We don't have many, but we have some drum songs. But most of our songs are call and answer and they're done with rattles. Now, we do have a thing we call stomp dance, where the women wear rattles on their legs and the men sing and the women keep the rhythm. Well, since I don't have ladies with rattles on their legs, I'll use my rattle here. And hey, you guys, come have a seat right there. Y'all come on, sit in front. Don't be shy. Have a seat. Are y'all gonna sit together there? I'm gonna have to look at those dots right there. Okay, all right. Now, what we're gonna do is we're gonna get everybody to help me out. It's a call and answer. Now, usually we answer back what we're calling out, but I'm gonna just get you guys to repeat what I holler out. Now, we're going to give it a test. I'm going to see, what's your name? What?
Juliet.
And what's your name?
Erica.
Erica, that's Samantha. Samantha, meet Juliet and Erica. Say hi. All right. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to test you. I'm going to get you, when I point at myself, I'm the only person talking. When I point this way, that means you got to repeat me. Now, The more people that show up at our dances and sing, the more people, we, Native Americans, we don't go to any function without bringing food or gifts, mostly food. And everybody brings food. So the more people that show up, the more food shows up. And the more food shows up, the more we get to eat. Anybody like to eat? You like to eat? Yeah, all right. You don't like to eat? Oh, you like to eat. Now, if you sing real loud, you get to eat first. So we're going to see who gets to eat today. All right. I'm going to start. We're going to use three words. Okay? We're going to go. Yo!
Yo!
Woo! She's going to eat. All right. Yo!
Yo!
Ooh, now we got three people that are hungry. All right. Let's see if these guys are hungry. Yo!
Yo!
All right. Let's have everybody together. Yo!
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 Yo! Yo!
Uh-huh!
Uh-huh!
All right. Yo means yes. Yo way means yes indeed. What do you think uh-huh means? Uh-huh. Yeah, uh-huh. That's what it means. So we're going to try this song. Yo, your turn. You got, all right. I know what a flat tire sounds like now, I tell you. Yo. By myself, I'm louder than y'all. All right. Yo,
yo,
uh-huh.
Uh-huh.
Hee, yeah.
Hee,
yeah.
Hee,
yeah.
Hee,
yeah.
Hee,
yeah.
Hee,
yeah.
Hee,
yeah.
Hee,
yeah. Hee, yeah.
Hee,
yeah. Hee, yeah.
Hee, yeah.
Hee, yeah.
Hee,
yeah. Hee, yeah. Hee, yeah.
Hee, yeah.
Hee,
yeah.
Hee, yeah. Hee, yeah.
Hee,
yeah. This guy's hungry, man, I tell you. All right. I think you're going to have, he's going to eat a big lunch this evening, yeah. Hey, I went to Fuddruckers, they got big hamburgers over there, yeah. So, y'all did good, give yourself a hand, y'all did real good. I got another story, and, you know, I like to do stories about where I'm from, and that's what I do. I'm a Southeastern native. Oh, it was a pleasure, glad y'all came by. I'm a Southeastern native, I'm from Louisiana, and all the stories that I have deal with where I'm from. I'm gonna do two stories for you guys. One of them is about Lake Pontchartrain. It wasn't called Lake Pontchartrain a long time ago, we just called it a big old pond. Now, long time ago there was this big pond, we call it Lake Pontchartrain now, and we had catfish in that pond. And those catfish were huge. They were big. Well, one day, Miko catfish was our leader. Miko catfish, he would swim every day. And he'd go over to the north side of that big pond and go, "Hey, catfish, how you doing today?" And the catfish would reply and they'd say, "We're doing just fine." And Miko would say, "Do you need anything?" And the catfish said, "No, we got everything we need. Oh, we're perfect." And Miko, well, leaders like to hear that. And he said, "Good, I'll see you tomorrow." And he'd take off. And he swam over to the north side, the south side, the east side, and the west side of that big old pond. And that's what he'd do. He asked if everybody was, and usually they were all okay. They didn't need anything. Well, days and days went by. And he was making his rounds again. When we got to that south side of that lake, he asked the fish, the catfish, how you doing? They were fine. Then he swam to the north side of that lake. But something made him stop. He heard the sound. And the water was vibrating. He was going, "Ooh, I wonder what that is." And the catfish were waiting for him to ask the question. He said, "No, wait a minute. Stay where you're at. I hear something. I feel something. I'm going up to check this out." And he swims up to the top. He gets to the top of the water and he looks out over the land. And he sees the trees and he sees something big running straight for that big old pond, full speed. It was running full speed. And as he's watching, it's getting bigger, and it's getting bigger, and it's getting bigger, and he goes, "Woo! If that thing don't stop and it hits this water, whew, we're gonna be swinging in the trees tonight. That thing hits this water." So he swims back down. He tells all the catfish, he says, "Catfish," they say, "What?" He says, "They got something big coming, and it's running fast, and it looks like it's not going to stop, and it hits the water. We're going to be swinging off the trees and the moon tonight." And he tells all the catfish, "I want you to take your catfish teeth, and I want you to clamp onto the grass. That way you won't fly in the air." So all the catfish do that, do this. They clamp down. And they said, "Okay, we're ready." So he swims back up to the top. He gets to the top, that thing is close, and he finally gets to see what it was. It was moving fast. It was running fast as it could. He saw it. It was the biggest. It was the meanest. It was the hairiest, ugliest thing he ever seen. It was the biggest buffalo he ever seen in his life. He was a catfish. It was probably the first buffalo ever seen in his life. But it was running straight for that big old pond. And Miko goes, "Uh-oh." Miko's on top of the water, and this thing's running straight for him. If he hits that pond, where's Miko going to wind up? In the trees. Big old splash. Miko goes, "Oh!" And Miko closes his eyes, and he braces himself for the impact of that buffalo. That buffalo's coming. That buffalo's running. He's running straight for that pond. He gets right by the edge of that pond, and right when he gets right there in the pond, he hits that pond, and he stops. Good breaks. He stops at the edge of that pond and he goes, "Woo! I am hot. I am tired. I am sweaty. And I don't smell too good. I think, you know what? I'll get some water. I'm going to get some water." And Miko's still like this because he's thinking that big old buffalo's going to hit the water. And he stops and he looks up and there's that buffalo right there. And he listens to the buffalo. Buffalo says, "I'm going to drink me some water." And the buffalo sticks his head down in the water and goes, starts drinking that water, and the water level just starts going down. And Miko goes, "Oh my goodness, if that big buffalo don't stop drinking his water, we ain't got no place to live." And finally the buffalo stops. Buffalo said, "I'm not thirsty no more, but I'm still hot and I'm sweaty and I still don't smell too good." Buffalo looks at that water, "Ooh, that's going to feel good." And the buffalo jumps right in that water and starts going back and forth and back and forth and back, just like a big old buffalo washing machine. Whoa, going back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And Miko's riding the wave screaming, "Woo!" And finally, the buffalo stops, gets out of the water, and shakes off. But boy, that water is dirty now. And it don't smell too good. Ooh, Miko was upset. And buffalo's getting ready to walk off. And catfish goes, "Hey!" Buffalo goes, "Huh?" Catfish says, "Me, I'm talking to you. Hey!" And buffalo turns around and looks down at catfish. And he says, "Huh?" Catfish, "The nerve of you. Coming here, drinking our water. Jumping in, dirty and all. You didn't even say please, thank you, or nothing. That you could even ask." And the buffalo turned around and went, "Huh, and walked off like nothing happened. Ooh, that Miko got mad. That catfish got so mad he almost turned into a redfish. That's how mad he got. But he calmed down because he had to think about all those catfish. He's a leader. He had to think about all those catfish and maybe they got hurt. So he swims back down. He gets back down to the water and boy, them catfish, they've been holding on, but boy, they shaking up. And he asked them if they were all right and they said, yeah, we're all right, we're just a little shaken up. And the water was so cloudy because of the buffalo making the dirt come up and all. And Miko said, what am I gonna do if that buffalo comes back and does that again? We won't be able to live here. Miko starts thinking, he got an idea. He told all the catfish, get a good night's sleep in case that buffalo comes back. I got an idea. He says, when that buffalo comes back, every catfish get on the bank of the big lake, big pond. And when that buffalo jumps in the water, catfish got something a lot of fish don't have. They got stingers. And when that big old buffalo jumps in the water, we're going to sting him. You got 10,000 catfish jumping on you, you're going to get stung. So that night, they all get a good night's sleep. They wake up the next morning, they get along the bank of that big old lake. Guess who showed up? Who do you think showed up? Buffalo showed up. Buffalo showed up. He's running. Y'all come sit down. He's running. He gets to the edge of that big pond. He does it again. He looks up. I'm hungry. I'm thirsty. I'm all this. And he jumps in the water and he starts to roll around. But this time, he's got a surprise. 10,000 catfish jump on him and they sting him in the head, they sting him in the eye, they sting him in the thigh, they stung him everywhere. And that buffalo jumped up going, woo! And he looked over and guess what he saw? Big old Miko catfish tell him, get off! So buffalo looks at that catfish as the leader and he takes that big old hoof and he goes right on that catfish's head. And he looked at all the other catfish, and before he got out of that water, he hit every catfish on top of the head. Then he jumped out the water, and he took off running. And as he was gone out of sight, you could hear him say these words. I ain't never coming back here. Them catfish are crazy. Now, ever since that day, if you come to Louisiana and you look out, you don't see no buffalo. Now, also, ever since that day, if you ever in Louisiana and you throw a line in the water and you pull out a catfish, check out that catfish's head. It's flat right on the top because that's the day catfish became flat-headed and that's the day there ain't no buffalo in Louisiana and that's a true Muskogean story. Thank you very much. So now you know why catfish got flat head and there ain't no buffalo in Louisiana. Yeah. That's an old story. I learned that one growing up, and I love that story. That's a pretty cool story. And I got another one. I said that you guys are giving me these ideas. Yeah, I've been a storyteller all my life, actually. My grandpa was funny. He didn't talk to a lot of people, but when he did, he would sit down and he would share stories, mostly with us, with the kids. And my grandpa one time, I remember, pulled me over. I was a little bitty old kid. And he said, come here. And he would sit down and he would talk to me and he would tell me a story. Usually them stories were 10, 15, 20, 30 minutes long, sometimes an hour, depending on how long his story is. But one day he comes up to me and he says, sit down. And he told me the story. It was 5 minutes long. And I sat there and listened. He said, go play. I found that strange. 5 minute story, you can go play. Later on that day, he's sitting outside again. He calls me over. He said, come here. You know that story I told you this morning? Tell me that story. Man, I told him that story back. It was 45 minutes long. He looked at me and smiled and said, you're going to be a storyteller. The thing I learned from it, you get a story. No matter how long it is or short, you take and you turn, take all the things that you've learned and the lessons that you learned, and you put it in those stories, and you make your stories teaching lessons, teaching stories. And that's the way our people did it. We'd look at things, we'd hear stuff, and we start putting our own lives into those stories and lessons that we learned, and we became teachers, not only storytellers, but teachers through our stories. And that's the way I do it. I've been doing it most of my life now. And you know what? I'm going to do this. I got a lot of stories I'm going to tell. Let's see, what we got here? We got Samantha. We got, what was your name again?
Erica.
And who we got here? Juliet. I can't forget that one, Juliet. Okay, who we got here? Oh, I like that. She's becoming part of my crew here. What's your name?
Molly
is six and Molly's in first grade. I love it. I teach kindergarten, so you know, I'm right below you there, but I'll be in first grade one day. All right. Let's see. We're going to think about a really good story. Let's see. I'm going to let you pick. I got so many stories in my head. Sometimes there's so many that I don't know which one to pick unless you tell me to pick one. Let's see. I'm going to name some animals. We got alligators. We already told a snake story. We got rabbits. We got possums. We got all kinds of alligators. Everybody wants an alligator story? Oh, I got a great alligator story. I'll give you two alligator stories for the price of one. How's that sound? I'll give you one that happened to me, and I'll give you one that happened a long time ago. Which one do you want? You want the one that happened to me first, or you want the one that happened a long time ago first? What was that? A long time ago. And what's your name again?
Ella.
Ella. Oh, Ella, that's a pretty, all these pretty names. I love that, you know. Who's that little young girl out back there? Julie? Julia. Oh, they wrote a lot of songs about Julia, I tell you. Now, let's give you the one long time ago about an alligator. Oh, it was a pleasure. Samantha, it has been a pleasure meeting you. You are just one unbelievably adorable, gorgeous young lady. Yes. All right. It was a pleasure. I'm glad y'all made it. Glad y'all made it. Now, alligator story. Long time ago, there was an alligator. He wasn't like the alligator we know today. This alligator was big, but his skin wasn't all bumpy and crinkly like it looks today. It was smooth and nice and tan, and oh, he just thought he was the best thing in the world. That alligator would sit on that bank. He'd be looking around. Anybody that came by, he'd eat them or beat them up. He was a bully. Anybody like bullies? Nah, we don't like bullies. He was a bully. And he would do that, and everybody left him alone. Because he thought he was the best thing in the whole swamps of Louisiana. Well, he laid there one day and he went to sleep. And he's snoring. And all of a sudden he hears a sound. What's your name again?
Ella.
He hears a sound and it's right here, about 2 feet from him in the high grass. And it's going. And it was Ella. She was a little rabbit. Ella the little rabbit, right there. And she was drinking up the water out that bayou. And the alligator goes, hey! And Ella goes, oh! And she looks over through the grass, and guess who she sees? That big alligator. And the alligator looks at Ella and says, Ella? He didn't know her name, but I'm telling you that. He says, rabbit? Why are you waking me up with all that noise? Was she making a lot of noise? She was just drinking. She goes, what? He says, you woke me up from my beauty nap. I'm going to get a wrinkle. And I don't want no wrinkle. Rabbit. And Ella goes, ooh, what were you doing? She says, I was drinking water. Oh, you were drinking water out of my bayou? Out of my water? You woke me up. You know what? When I get woken up from my sleep, I'm angry. I'm tired, I'm cross, and I'm hungry. You know what I'd like to eat right now? Rabbit. What do you think he would like to eat right now?
Rabbit.
No, Ella told him. He says, he asked Ella, Ella, or rabbit, what do you think I'd like to eat? And Ella went, hamburger? Alligator said, I don't want to eat no hamburger, rabbit. What do you think I want to eat, rabbit? And Ella went, deer? Alligator said, I don't want to eat no deer, rabbit. What do you think I want to eat, rabbit? And Ella went, possum? She didn't want to say that word, rabbit. But the alligator looked at her and said, I want to eat rabbit right now, rabbit. And Ella went, ooh, her nose started twinkling, her hind legs were doing this. Now, everybody thinks that Ella could have just ran away. You don't know alligators that well. Alligators are fast. They'll run people down. I've been treed by them before. They're fast. On a straight run, you can't beat them. And that rabbit was right there, and there's no way that rabbit would have got away. Now, rabbit, though, Ella, she was smart. She was a trickster. She looked over at that alligator and go, whoa, whoa, wait a minute, alligator. I know why I came here. And the alligator looked at her and said you came here to drink my water. No, I got water, but I came here for another reason. Because you see, Ella knew that he was a bully and that he thought he was the best thing in the world. And that's what bullies think. If they think somebody's better than him, they get angry. She said, I came here to tell you that there's another creature out in those woods over there, in them swamps, that told me to come here and tell you he's bigger, better, smarter, and everything than you are. You think that alligator liked hearing that? Mm-mm. That alligator said, tell that creature to come here. And Alice said, what? He said, go get that creature and tell him to come here. I'll go get him. She could get away now, right? So she turned around to run off and she said, not that easy. That alligator has eaten half my family, beat up half my friends, and been a bully for a long time. I'm going to teach that alligator a lesson. Now, how is a rabbit going to teach an alligator a lesson? She's smart. She's got brains. And she's a trickster. She looks at the alligator and said, nope, can't go get him. Alligator says, what? Can't go get him. He's not going to come here. You got to go to him. I got to go to him. Oh, no. He's bigger, badder. He's better than you. He's smarter. And he said, if you want to go see him, you got to go to him. Alligator said, bring me there. And Ella starts running. Now, alligators are good on a straight run. But if you zigzag, they're not that great. And Ella, boy, she was going to make that alligator hurt. She went in and out the big cypress knees and the trees, and he couldn't make those bends, and he'd boom, run into the tree. Boom, run into the bushes. Boom, his nose was bleeding, and now Ella was running, looking back, going, hee, she was laughing, and she stopped. She says, hey, alligator, what's the matter? You can't keep up with me? Woo, that made that alligator mad. He ran even faster and beat those trees up with his nose even more. Then they got to the high grass in the marsh. And she told him this, stop right here in the high grass. I'll be right back. I'm going to go get him. Alligator's rubbing his nose like this. Okay, go get him. I'm ready for him now. Ella starts to walk off. And Ella stops. And she turns around and she looks at him. She says, alligator, I forgot to tell you one thing. What you forgot to tell me, the alligator said. I forgot to tell you that when that big creature gets mad, fire comes out of his mouth. Alligator goes, excuse me? Fire comes out of his mouth? Oh, yeah, when he gets mad. And all of a sudden, alligator looks up, and there's birds in the trees, animals in the trees, and they're all watching to see if alligator's going back down. The bully. Alligator looks up and says, I ain't worried about that fire. Go get that creature. I'm not worried about that fire. Ella says, okay. She starts to run. She stops again. She turns around. She says, I forgot to tell you one more thing. Alligator says, what? I forgot to tell you, when he gets really mad, his teeth get real long and sharp. Alligator goes, mm-hmm. His teeth get real long and sharp. Fire comes out of his mouth. And Ella goes, yeah, I'm going to go get him. And Alligator starts to stop her and looks up, and there's more animals around. So he can't show that he's scared. And she said, I'm going to go get him. He says, okay. But he wasn't so mean this time. And right as she's gone, she knows she's getting him. She turns around and says, oh, forgot to tell you one more thing. He goes, oh, no, not one more thing. Oh, yeah, one more thing. When he gets real mad, his nails get real long, and he's got wings that come out of his back. Ooh, Alligator looks around, and there's more animals in the trees. And Alligator says, rabbit, I got an idea. I got to go somewhere. Could you just tell him I'll come back later? Oh, no problem. Get him. You can be here real quick. He might be busy. No, he's not busy. I'm going to go get him. I'll be right back. And she runs off. She goes to the back of the high grass, and she starts rolling on the grass and laughing because there ain't no such creature as that. She made it all up. He's in there shaking. Ooh, ooh, that big creature's going to come. He's going to burn me up. He's going to drag me in the sky. He's going to eat me. Oh, my goodness. And he looks up at the sky, and he says, hey, Abamico, creator, I got to ask you a favor. I promise, if you let me out of this thing, I will be the best alligator in the world. I will never bite, hurt, or eat anybody up before, unless I'm hungry. He don't hear no sound. You see, when people get in animals get in a jam, and all of a sudden everything's going good for them, and all of a sudden they get in a jam, they start saying, please help me. But he didn't think about that until now. Well, nothing showed up, and he's still sitting in that grass. Rabbit hollers out, hey, Alligator, I told him what you said. And he's mad. He's real mad. In fact, he's burning everything up. And Rabbit had taken and started a fire in that high, dry grass. And the fire started around that alligator. Before Alligator could run, he was surrounded by fire. And Rabbit said, have a good day, Alligator. I'll see you later. And she took off. Well, the fire came around that big old alligator, and it covered that alligator up. That alligator screamed and started running through that fire. Closed his eyes and ran through that fire. And did not stop till he got back to the bayou and he jumped in. And when he jumped in, you could hear his skin go shh, because he was all burnt up. Now, he laid in that water for a long time. And then finally, he crawled up underneath the ledge in the mud and just laid there and went to sleep because that mud felt good on his burnt body. After a long time he'd been sleeping, he swam out from under that ledge and got on the bank, and he looked at his arms and he looked at his body, and it was all crinkly and it was all, oh, it didn't look like it did before. Oh, he cried himself to sleep. He laid on that bank for a long time crying. He laid on that bank for a long time sleeping. Then finally, after a long time, you know who showed up again? Listen to this. Who showed up?
Rabbit
showed up. And Alligator thought he was dreaming. And he goes, who's drinking? And he looks at his rabbit. He said, Rabbit, drink all the water you want. And he jumped in the bayou. Ever since that day, if you go in the swamps of Louisiana, you see that alligator come up, and they look around. And if you make any sharp noises or throw something in the water, they go underneath, because they still think that fire creature's out there in that swamp looking for them. And that's why alligators today are a lot more nicer. They don't bite people unless they're hungry. And anything bigger than they are, they leave them alone. And that's a true Choctaw story. Y'all like that story?
Yeah.
So I'm glad y'all did. All right. Hey, we got more people. Come in and sit down. I don't know how much time I got left. How much time do I have left? I don't have a clock. How much time do I have? Okay, great. I'm endless. All right, here we go. All right, you guys want to pick a story this time? Or do y'all want to do a song? Oh, wait, let's do a song. Y'all like dancing? Oh. Okay, y'all want to do a song? Now y'all stand up. You got to stand up too. Come on, stand up. We need four people for this. Is that your sister?
Yeah.
She's a Raggedy Ann doll. Look at that. We need another partner. We need another partner. All right, right there. We need two. I want to see who can do this the best. All right, come on, get up there. You can do it. It's not fun. Hey, if I can do it with a broken ankle, I know you can do it. All right. Now, this is actually, we have songs and dances for everything. Well, you know, why don't you guys get up here? What's that? What's your name again?
Molly
and Ella. Ella, y'all come up here. Y'all come up here. Right there. Your partner don't want to come up. We need to have a partner. You know what? You come do it by yourself over here. I know we don't usually don't do it by ourselves, but since your partner don't want to come up, we'll do it. I'll be your partner. How's that sound? Okay. Now, the song, we have songs about mosquitoes. We got songs about raccoons. We got songs about everything. We got songs about alligators. We even got this song called a guinea song. It's like a guinea dance. And it goes... It's got that beat. Now, when you're dancing, you guys are usually walking, and you're dancing with the rhythm, and the song goes like this. Yo, wanna hey, hey, yo, wanna hey, hey, yo, wanna hey, hey, yo, hey, yo, wanna hey, hey, yo, wanna hey, hey, yo, wanna hey, hey, yo, jump, yo, jump, yo, jump. That's the way the song goes. Now, what we do is that, you know what, let's see. I need a partner. You come on up here. I'm going to get you a partner. Let's see. That guy over there with the red shirt, you can come be her partner. Yeah, come over here. All right. There you go. Come on here. Okay, I'm going to show you that. Now, let's see. Now, the way we work this, and you're going to hold hands. Like, you're going to hold this hand here. Like that. Like that. Okay, you got it. And then you're going to go under and hold that hand. Like that. Now, yeah, just like that. And then like this. Let's see. I'm going to be on your left side. Okay. And I'm going to take my right hand. You're going to get on. You're on the right side. Okay. Like this. Like we're doing a shake. Okay. Now, the way this works is when the music starts, you start dancing like this. You work with the rhythm. And then we get to a point where we go, heel jump. And then you stop. And then the boy will go backwards and the girl will go frontwards. Let's try it. Jump. And rhythm, like this. Like you both feet together. Like that. Yeah. Until I go, hey, stop. Okay? That's the way we're going to work it. All right? Let's see. We need a partner for her now. Okay, who's going to be a partner? You want to be a partner? Who wants to be a partner? Somebody ran away. Okay. You want to be a partner? Want to be a partner? Okay, well, wait. You want to be a partner? Come on up here. All right. Now you saw how we did it. All right. All right, hold hands. Got to hold hands. Okay, I'm going to go here, and I'm going to do it. I'm going to show you how it's done, and we're going to let you guys decide who the best couple is. Usually we follow in a line, but since we're going to let you stand right in place and do this, okay? When I start, you ready? Get them feet up. Yo, wanna hey, hey. Face me again, and we're going to do it one more time. Indian aerobics. All right, here we go. Hold them hands. Now, you follow the drum beat on how fast I go. If I go slow, you go slow. If I go fast, you go fast. I hope you had your exercise. Or if you didn't have your exercise, you're going to get it now. All right, here we go. Here we go. Get that rhythm going. Yo, wanna hey, hey, yo, wanna hey. That was the guinea dance. Yeah, you know, when two guineas meet in the field, they see each other, they go, woo, and they start dancing. Yeah, like that, going in twirls, okay? Now, everybody, you know what? I think I got time for another story, right? Okay. Oh, what, a true story? Oh, all right, I'll give you a true story. All right, I'll give you that alligator story I was going to tell you earlier. Oh, give me a shake. All right, it was a pleasure meeting you.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. True story. All right. You want the true alligator story?
Yeah.
I got two. I'm going to tell you one with me and my uncle. Okay? One day, my uncle came up to me and said, you're going to come alligator hunting with me. And I went, ooh, that's going to be good. So I get ready. He gets his boat ready. And he's got this boat. It's about 19 feet long, made out of cypress, beautiful boat, handmade. He made all his own boats himself. And he says, we're going to go alligator hunting. He says, so get in. So I got in, and in the middle of the boat was a basket. And that basket had oyster shells in it, about that many. And he says, all right, and he hands me this axe, little bitty hand axe, about that big, which I still got today. And he hands it to me, he says, put it in front of you, I'll tell you what to do with it when it's time. And we get in, and he's got a piece of rope, which I still have that piece of rope. He's got a piece of rope that's probably about 20 feet long. And he's got a knife in his belt, and he's got a pistol, but he's got it stuck here. I don't know why he had the pistol, because he never used it. And we get in, and we're paddling in that boat through that bayou. And he says, okay. When we see the alligator that we want, we're going to stop. I'll let you know. And when that alligator jumps in the boat, I went, huh? He said, when the alligator jumps in the boat, if he jumps in this way, you take your little axe, you hit him on top of the head. If he jumps in this way, you catch him right there. I said, I'm still trying to get over the alligator jumping in the boat. Well, I'm thinking, my uncle's playing with me. There ain't no alligator going to jump in a boat. So we're paddling. And he goes, shh. I stop. He says, so we stop. We back paddle. And he goes, there's about a 9.5-foot alligator sitting on that bank. About from here to that wall. And I go, and I'm thinking, there ain't no way that alligator's going to jump from that bank into our boat. I'm thinking that. So, you know, he said, so I turned around, I got on the bow and put my feet up there, and I got my little axe. My uncle does this. He jumps in the water, but not until he does this. He takes an oyster shell, and he does this. Boom, he throws that oyster shell. He hits that alligator right about there. Alligator did this number, slid down in the water. My uncle jumped in the water at the same time, and they both disappeared under the water. I said, I knew my uncle was crazy. Now I know he is. All of a sudden, guess what happened? Alligator comes flying in the boat. That man took that alligator from underneath and did this number, and he flipped him right in the boat. That alligator was right in between my legs. Boom. And that alligator, I was like this, and the alligator was like this, because he didn't know what happened. The only thing I could think of is, whoo, boom, hit him in the head. Hit him in the head twice. Well, before my uncle told me about hitting the alligator in the head, you know what he told me? He said, don't you miss that alligator. You miss that alligator hit my boat, then it's me and you. I sat there and I hit that alligator twice, and the alligator's there and he stopped. Uncle climbs back in the boat and he looks and he goes, good job, but why he had him twice? Well, make sure he's dead. And I'm sitting there and I'm paddling that boat. He said, next alligator we're going to get, we're going to make it a little smaller. The next one was 9 feet long. But you know, I started thinking, what made this little 12-year-old boy hit that alligator and not miss him? What? I watched my uncle throw a 9.5-foot alligator, and he's only 5'6". He threw that alligator in that boat like it was nothing. I would rather deal with that alligator than my uncle if I hit that boat. That's what made me stop hitting that boat. And that's a true story. You like that story?
Yeah,
that's a true story. One more. This is a funny one. Another alligator. Greyhawk used to get in a lot of, you know, I lived in a swamp area. I lived in an area where there's a lot of swamps. And so when I got home from school, guess where I disappeared to? After I did my homework and did all the stuff I needed to do, I was in the swamps. Well, me and my cousin one day were walking through the swamps. And guess what we found? An alligator. We found an alligator. He wasn't too big, though. He was only about 5 feet, maybe. We'll see, 5 feet. That's 1, 2, 3. About like that. He wasn't really that big. Okay, that's a big lizard, huh? Yeah. He was about 5 feet. And my cousin says, "Hey, look at that alligator over there." And I said, "Yeah." "I dare you to go grab his tail." "What?" "I dare you to go grab." You don't tell an 11-year-old boy, "Dare." Then he did something. He said, "What's the matter? You chicken?" Ooh, I didn't want to be called no chicken. So guess what I did? I went and grabbed that alligator by his tail. But it surprised me. He didn't just lay there. I grabbed that alligator and I grabbed him and I dug in and he started pulling that way toward the bayou. And I'm holding him. I got him. And he's doing this and I'm doing that. And I start dragging him like this, because as long as I kept dragging him, he was trying to drag and he kept in a straight line. And my cousin's laughing at me. And I said, "I need some help here." So he picks up a big stick and he starts beating the alligator on the head so it won't turn around and bite me. And it's like, I'm dragging it. So I don't realize how far I've been dragging it, but before you know it, I'm behind a house. And my mom's there. And she looks, and all she sees is the top of our head through the grass. She said, "What y'all doing?" My cousin said, "We got an alligator." And she sees him about 9 feet behind doing this with a stick, and me doing this. Finally, we get to the opening. She said, "Boy, I let that alligator go." "I ain't letting that alligator go. He's going to turn around and bite me." And finally, we get there, and my dad comes around the corner. He said, "Boy, let that alligator go." I let that alligator go that quick. Same thing with my uncle. I'd rather deal with that alligator than my daddy. That's it. And that's a boy growing up in the swamp. You know what? I played with alligators. I did a lot of stuff. Still got my fingers. I still got all my toes. Yeah. Just got to know. Hey, remember that alligator story I told you? They're really not mean alligators. It's just sometimes you can't play with them. Yeah, you just can't play with them. Well, you know, guys, my name's Grayhawk. I'm from New Orleans, from Louisiana. I'm from the Muscogee Nation. I'm Houma and I'm Choctaw. And I came here to tell some stories today for you. I hope you enjoyed my stories. I hope you enjoyed the dancing.